Hi, everybody, and welcome back to the next chapter in SOC 101, or everything you wanted to know about a computer but were afraid to ask. I am Professor Adam Teman of the Enix Labs at Bar-Ilan University, and now we'll be moving over to Lecture 6, the Memory Hierarchy. So we have six parts to this lecture, and let's start with an introduction to the memory hierarchy. So I'm imagining you've seen such an illustration before of what we call the pyramid of memory or the memory hierarchy. And what we have in this kind of nice illustration is at the top, we have the CPU or whatever our computational type of unit is. And the closest thing to the CPU are the registers, the CPU registers, which are flip-flops, which we can access in like a sub-cycle type of an asynchronous even type of an access. The problem with CPU registers is that they're really expensive. It takes lots of transistors to implement them. And therefore, what we have to do is we have to go down through the hierarchy, where as we go farther down, we go to different types of technologies and ways to implement memory, and we get much more memory. And that's why this kind of x-axis is the capacity or the density of the memory. However, it becomes slower, which means that it takes longer, there's a longer latency to access this type of memory, and the cost is much higher for each one of these. So when we go down, our basic thing that's on chip is SRAM, and that's usually called caches, level 1, level 2, level 3, level 4. We call them inner level and outer level caches. That's what we'll be discussing in the first half of the lecture today. When we finish the maximum amount of cache that we can actually put on the chip itself, we have to go off chip, which has a really an additional level of expense, but there we can get much bigger memories. And what we call main memory is DRAM. And DRAM we discussed a bit in the last lecture, and that's basically a completely different processing technology, and therefore it's not made on the same chip as the CPU and the rest of the computational units, but special chips in special fabs. But we can get much higher density for DRAM. Once DRAM is really exploited to the maximum, we have to go even further, and then we have the different types of secondary storage, where it used to be just hard disks, you know, the traditional magnetic type of hard disks, and maybe some sort of archival storage such as a tape. In recent years, we've had something we call storage class memory, which started with flash, but now it has different types of options such as PCM, MRAM, and ReRAM, which are really coming in, and we have to see how they're going to be used. So that's the basic memory hierarchy that I am assuming you've seen before, and now we're going to be really going over kind of how this works inside a computer architecture. So why is this really important, the subject we're going to be discussing now? And it's because of this thing that is known as the processor DRAM gap. So in 1980, a microprocessor, it really could do one instruction and is about the same time as DRAM access. And therefore, you could basically put your memory as a DRAM. But when we got to, you know, a few decades later, a microprocessor already executes about 1,000 instructions in the same time as DRAM access. And the reason is that the processor's capabilities and performance really went up very quickly, you know, exponentially, in fact, whereas the memories went up much, much, much slower. So CPU performance increased by about 55% per year until around 2004, whereas DRAM only increased about 7% per year. And that provided this big gap in the performance that we were able to access DRAM versus the performance that the processor works at. And so slow DRAM access really has disastrous impact on CPU performance because, you know, our main memory is this DRAM, and once it takes a lot of time to actually access it, that's that really slows us down. So let's look for a second at typical memory access patterns to understand how the main kind of method to address this DRAM gap is. So first of all, if we look at the first thing that we're doing in our computer is we're fetching instructions. And fetching instructions is usually one instruction after the other. So you can see here, if we have this kind of nice graph from MIT, you have time and you have address over here. And what we see is that we usually kind of address consecutive addresses to go and fetch instruction after instruction. So that's a kind of a common type of a pattern that we'll see. Then what happens is we have loops, you know, and loops are kind of go-tos in assembly code. And so what we're going to do is after this sequential kind of instruction, we're going to jump back and do the same thing over and over again. We also may jump to different address spaces, and that's like a branch or some sort of a subroutine call. The second type of memory access is our stack. So we have our, each of our programs has its stack, and the stack is in a certain type of area of memory. So we're going to be, for a while we're inside that same procedure, we're going to be accessing that same area of memory. Once we branch to another procedure, the stack is going to change, but then we're going to be again centralized around that kind of area of the stack of that procedure. And finally, we have data access, where data access is maybe more sporadic than the kind of really regular type of access of instructions or the closed area of stacks. But again, all these types of data, they are going to be a lot of times really close to each other. So all kinds of structs or arrays and so forth, they're going to be kind of in the same type of an area. And another thing is we're going to be copying a lot of stuff over, especially when we branch and so forth. So then we have this sequential kind of access as well, as we can see here when we move between data structures. But a common thing that we can see about looking at this type of a typical, you know, operating pattern of a different type of a, you know, workload on a CPU is that we have a limited working set size. So really, if we start, you know, our operation with some sort of reset and we start continuing over time, we see that the working set of the programs, it grows and grows and grows, but at some point it saturates, and we kind of really have usually a limited working set size of many types of different programs. And that leads us to the principle of locality. So what we saw before is that programs access a small portion of their address space at any given time. And we can look at this in two kind of categories. The first one is called temporal locality, or locality in time. So recently accessed items are likely to be accessed again soon. So where does that happen? For example, if we're looping, we're going to go back to the same instructions that we accessed not long ago. If we just access a stack variable, there's a good chance we're going to access it again. And the same thing with the data structure. If we went to some sort of a struct or something like that, there's a good chance we're going to use it more than once within our program. The other type of locality is known as spatial locality, or locality in space. Okay, and that means that items that are near to the ones that were just recently accessed are likely to be accessed again soon. So again, we saw that there's this sequential type of instruction access. So usually after we accessed one instruction, we're going to access the one that comes right after it and so forth. Another thing is like arrays or structs, they're usually going to be ordered in some sort of a sequential type of form inside our memory. So if we went to we may iterate over an array, we're going to go to the first element, then the second and third. So we're going to go to things that are close together. So really, when we look at locality in time and locality in space, they kind of address that whole type of typical access pattern that we see on our working set on the previous slide. And so how do we take advantage of this locality? And kind of a good type of overview of doing this is that we can just store everything on our secondary storage on our disk, which has, we can assume, an unlimited amount of space on our, you know, SSDs or hard disks or so forth. But that's really, really far away from our CPU and our registers that are, accessed within a single cycle or within the pipeline of the processor. So what we're going to do then is recently accessed and nearby items for temporal and spatial locality, we're going to copy them to our main memory, our DRAM. And our DRAM is much, much orders of magnitude faster than going to this secondary storage. And then what we're going to do is take our DRAM, which is much faster than secondary storage, but it's still kind of slow relative to on-chip things, we're going to copy it into our limited amount of cache of our SRAM that's on the computer. So if we do this, we're going to be able to take care of both temporal and spatial locality by kind of copying the things that we think we're going to use, or that by the fact that they're close together or that we use them recently, into, you know, our on-chip memory that we can actually access really frequently. So the bottom line is that we do something that we call caching. So the mismatch between a processor and memory speeds leads us to a new level, which is the memory cache, and that is a very strange name. So what is a cache? Is it cash like money? No, it's actually cash in this way, C-A-C-H-E. And what is cache according to the dictionary? A collection of items of the same type stored in a hidden or inaccessible place, such as an ARMS cache. That doesn't exactly sound like something we need for memory. Maybe it's store away and hiding. Are we hiding something? Not really. Or for future use. So that's what it is. That's why they decided to call this a cache. We're taking a bunch of memory that's on an outer level, a farther away type of a memory, such as DRAM or disk or something like that, and we're moving it closer to our processor or our executional unit into something that's close by. So similar to, you know, a library book where we bring it over to the table because we're going to be reading it soon. So caches are implemented usually with the same IC processing technology as the CPU and usually integrated on the same chip. And that's why it's usually going to be SRAM, which is what we call logic compatible. It's faster, but it's much more expensive than DRAM memory or secondary storage. And a cache is a copy of a subset of main memory. So usually whatever we have in DRAM, we're going to copy it over here and not remove it from here and move it into the cache. We're just going to have a copy of it. So taking that, let's look at our computer. We have our CPU over here, and our CPU has, you know, a bus which has, you know, address, data, and control lines that go to the on-chip interconnect, and we saw that they can talk to the DRAM controller and then go out through a DDR interface to the main memory, which has both our program and data stored in it, and it can go to, you know, types of I/O controllers to memory mapped I/O. So that's how our kind of CPU worked according to what we saw in the last few lectures. Well, what is a cache? And we also discussed this briefly, but we're just going to put another level of storage in between, you know, all of this. This may sit in front of the on-chip interconnect, may sit after it, doesn't really matter, but we still have this type of a buffer, this type of a hierarchy of memories, and you see we have here level 1, level 2, level 3 cache. There may be different types that are going to store some of the memory from DRAM much closer to the CPU, so we don't have to go through all of this mess kind of to get to just read or write a byte of data. So let's look at the memory hierarchy in another type of a view. The closest to the CPU is going to be those registers, and they're on the data path, and really they can take like something like a cycle or even subcycle to access them, but it's really small and limited. We're going to have something like 1 kilobyte, the order of 1 kilobyte of memory in registers. And then we need to go to SRAM, which is much more dense than those registers. And then we have a cache hierarchy, something like a level 1, level 2, and level 3 cache, which are still on chip. And there you see it's going to take several cycles, maybe even less than that, depending on our architecture and our implementation, to access the level 1 cache. But it's also going to be in the dozens of kilobyte range. It's not going to usually be more than that. And we're going to see during this lecture exactly why. Then we're going to go a bit farther to a bigger cache, which is going to be level 2, which is going to take more cycles to access, but still several cycles, not that many. And it's going to be substantially larger than the level 1 cache, but still in the sub-megabyte kind of size. Then we'll go to a level 3 cache, and that's going to be already a few more cycles, as you can see, but it's going to be much, much larger in that case. Another thing is that level 1 and sometimes level 2 may be shared by a CPU, by a certain processing unit, whereas level 3 may be shared across all of the CPUs that we'll have on type of a multi-core chip. After a level 3 cache, and sometimes it's after level 2, and sometimes we don't even have more than, you know, the first level kind of memories, which we might also call a tightly coupled memory. But after the lowest, furthest out level of cache, we're going to go over to main memory. Main memory, again, is DRAM. That's off-chip. It's on those DIMMs and so forth that we discussed in the last lecture. And they're already going to take probably hundreds of cycles to access, but we're going to be able to put gigabytes over there. I mean, for many years now, we've had computers that need at least whatever, something like 8 gigabyte to run something like Windows. And usually we're going to have at least 16 gigabytes of memory on our computer. The you know, highest end servers and these types of real Apple Mac Pros that they've been selling for the highest prices that go for $50,000, they're going to have a terabyte even of DRAM on their board. But usually we're talking about several gigabyte, maybe several dozen gigabyte that we're going to have on something like a personal computer. And then when we want to go to really bigger storage, we go maybe to our, you know, kind of storage class memory, which would be a flash drive or something like that, that's going to be already, you know, hundreds of gigabytes, maybe up to a terabyte, but it's already going to have many microseconds to access it. And then finally, we still use these mechanical devices, which are very, very, very cheap, and we're going to have terabytes of those hard disks, but it's going to take millions and millions of cycles to access those hard disks. So the one important thing is that the memory hierarchy is inclusive. That means whatever we have in the L1 cache, and as you see, sometimes we call it cache, similar to, you know, cash money, we use a dollar sign to show that that's cash. So L1 cache is going to be a subset of what is in the main memory, and the main memory is going to be a subset of what is in the hard disk. So we really copy things. We don't replace things that are over here. We will see that sometimes things get dirty because if we write to something and it hasn't been written back. But in general, we make a copy of things as we move it over. We don't move it and erase where it came from.